Good morning, dear students. In the last class, we discussed about the basic elements of optical communication, advantages, disadvantages, applications, and so on. In today's class, we are going to learn the ray theory transmission and properties of ray optics. What is a ray? A ray is a part of light, and in a homogeneous medium, it is a straight line. The homogeneous medium means it has uniform properties throughout its volume, that is, without any irregularities. That is, it does not have lumps of different steps in it. In this session, I'll be discussing about the properties of ray optics. The properties are law of reflection, law of refraction, Snell's law, critical angle, total internal reflection, numerical aperture, acceptance angle, and types of rays. Let us start with law of reflection. It states that the angle of incidence theta 1 is equal to angle of reflection theta 2. For example, when a wave approaches a reflecting surface such as mirror, the wave that strikes the surface is called incident wave, and the wave that bounces back is called reflected wave. The amount of incident energy that is reflected from a surface depends on two ways. One is nature of the surface. One is the nature of the surface, and the second one is angle at which the wave strikes the surface. Next, law of refraction. When a light ray travels from one medium to another medium, bending of light occurs. That is, when a light ray passes from rarer medium to the denser medium, you can see bending of light. Here the rarer medium is air and the denser medium is glass. So we have a doubt in this, what causes the bending of lights, right? Bending of light occurs mainly due to variation in the speed of light. For air medium, the refractive index is 1.003 and the speed of light is 2.8 × 10⁸ meters per second. Similarly, for glass, the refractive index is 1.5 and the speed is 1.9 × 10⁸ meters per second. So due to this variation, bending occurs. Let us observe some examples in our day-to-day life experience. For example, when a pencil or a spoon is partially immersed in water, it appears to be broken at the interface of air and water. Let us see why does it happen. Consider a water tumbler and a pencil or spoon. When a pencil or spoon is partially immersed in water in a glass tumbler, it appears bent or broken to the observer. But we know the fact that spoon is not bent at all, it just appears to be so. In this case, the light reaching observed from the portion of the spoon inside water seems to come from different direction compared to the part above the water. This makes the spoon appear to be displaced at the interface. Let us see refractive index. It is the ratio of speed of light in vacuum to the speed of light in material. Therefore, refractive index can be represented as n is equal to c by v. Here, c is the speed of light in vacuum and v is the speed of light in material. Next one is Snell's law. Snell's law explains when light enters from one medium to other medium with a different refractive index, at the time there will be refraction phenomena which is happening. And by what quantity, if the refraction phenomena is happening, that is being explained by Snell's law. Therefore, Snell's law states that how light ray reacts when it meets the interface of two medium having different index of refraction. Therefore, the formula for Snell's law is sine theta 1 divided by sine theta 2 is equal to N2 divided by N1, where N1 is the angle of incident, N2 is the angle of refraction. So N1 and N2 are the, theta 1 is the angle of incident and theta 2 is the angle of refraction, and N1 and N2 are the refractive indices of medium 1 and 2 respectively. So Snell's law mainly used to find the refractive index of unknown material. And the next one is critical angle. When a ray travels from denser medium to the rarer medium, that is in the case of a ray travel from glass medium to the air medium, that is N1 is greater than N2, then the angle of refraction is greater than the angle of incidence and the refracted ray moves away from the normal. If the angle of incident is increased further, the angle of refraction also increases, and at a particular angle of incident, the angle of refraction becomes 90 degrees, and the ray travel along in the media interface. This angle of incident at which the refractor angle becomes 90 degrees is called as critical angle. The formula for critical angle is sine theta c divided by, so we know by using Snell's law, we know the formula for Snell's law, that is sine theta 1 divided by sine theta 2. Here the theta 1 is nothing but theta c. Again, the theta 2 is 90 degrees, right? So sine theta c divided by sine 90 is equal to n2 divided by n1. So what is the value of sine 90? We know the value of sine 90 is equal to 1. Therefore, sine theta c is equal to n2 divided by n1. So critical angle can be represented in terms of degrees, that is theta c is equal to sine inverse of n2 divided by theta c is equal to sine inverse of n2 divided by n1. The next one is total internal reflection. When the angle of incidence increased beyond the critical angle, no refracted ray exists and the incident light ray is refracted back into the same medium. This phenomenon is called total internal reflections. There we have two basic requirements of total internal reflection. First one is the light ray passes from denser medium to the rarer medium, and the second one is angle of incidence should be greater than the critical angle. The next one is numerical aperture. It's a parameter or a figure of merit which represents light gathering or collecting capability of the fiber. So this numerical aperture is a dimensionless number. Its value ranges from 0 to 1. The formula for calculating numerical aperture is Na is equal to N1 into root of 2 delta, where N1 is the refractive index of the core and delta is the index difference. So we have another formula to collect the numerical aperture, that is Na is equal to, Na represent numerical aperture. So the value of Na is equal to root of N1 square minus N2 square, where N1 is the refractive index of the core and N2 is the refractive index of the cladding. Next one is acceptance angle. A light ray should be guided through an optical fiber and it must enter the core with an angle less than acceptance angle is called acceptance angle of the fiber. If a ray enters the fiber with an angle greater than the acceptance angle, then it will be loft of the cladding. So the acceptance angle can be defined as the maximum angle at which a light ray may enter into the core and propagate along the core medium. The formula for calculation of acceptance angle is given as theta A is equal to sine inverse of Na. And this acceptance angle can be easily calculated for meridional rays. Now let us see the acceptance cone. You can see the acceptance cone here. Light ray which enters into the core medium within an acceptance angle is allowed to propagate into the core medium throughout. And the light ray which passes out of the cone gets the out. Acceptance angle cone is divided by rotating the acceptance angle above the fiber axis. It is a cone within which optical path may be coupled into the bound mode of optical fiber. Let us now discuss about the different types of rays. The three different types of rays are skew rays, meridional rays, and the axial rays. Skew rays are the rays which do not pass through the fiber axis and propagate around the axis on zigzag path. That is, move on helical path around the fiber. And if you look this is the view along the fiber axis, and this is the ray path view along the plane which is normal to the fiber axis. Since this is the axis is following through this path. Going through this path. If you look fiber from this side, you will see these reflections. These movements of rays, light rays, in this way, I have denoted as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In this way, it is moving. Here, the light rays are moving in clockwise manner and they do not cross the fiber axis. Since it takes a helical path, it travels very slower. The helical path traced through the fiber gives a change in direction of 2 gamma at each reflections, where gamma is the angle between the projection of ray in 2 dimension and the radius of the fiber core at the point of reflection. The skew rays are more difficult to track as they do not lie in a single plane. Skew rays take maximum possible light ray path because of greater acceptance angle. Next, we can see the meridional rays. Meridional rays are the rays which passes through the fiber axis. In the diagram, we can see the meridional rays and how the meridional rays propagate inside the optical fiber. The first diagram shows the ray path view along the fiber axis. This is the axis of the fiber. If you see the diagram along the axis of the fiber, this is the path view of this ray of meridional rays. And this diagram shows the ray path view of the plane which is normal to the fiber axis. If you look into the fiber from this side, we will see this kind of shape and this ray propagates. Since the meridional ray, the ray entering through the axis of the fiber and they crosses the fiber axis at each reflection. As we know that the light rays propagate inside the optical fiber with total internal reflection. And here, if you note, the first reflection is noted as 1 and the second place of reflection is noted as 2 and the third reflection place is as 3. And I have shown 3 reflections in the diagram, that is 1, 2 and 3. At each time it reflected, it passes through the axis of the fiber. So meridional rays cross the optical fiber axis at each reflection. Okay. So this is the property of meridional rays. Since the meridional rays lies in a single plane, it is easy to track and travels along the fiber. Meridional rays takes comparatively lesser light ray path because of lesser acceptance angle. These rays travel slower because of total internal reflections. There are two classes of meridional rays. They are bound rays, unbound rays. Bound rays are the rays can be trapped inside the core and propagate along the fiber axis. And the unbound rays are the rays that get refracted out of the fiber core. And the final one is axial ray. Axial ray always takes a straight path or straight line path. They travel along the axis of the fiber and stays at the axis at the time. And here the acceptance angle is zero, so they rarely take light ray path. And since they travel in a straight line path along the axis, they travel very fast. Now let us summarize the topics we have discussed today. We have discussed the basics of ray optics, relation between acceptance angle and numerical aperture, propagation of light in different types of rays. So based on today's classes, I will assign a small work for you all. So you all have to compare the three types of rays and submit the comparison to me within 2 days. Hope you have understood. Thank you, dear students.